Let's be called to worship, standing as we are, with Psalm 134, as we typically do on the Lord's Day evenings. Come and bless the Lord, all you servants of the Lord who stand by night in the house of the Lord. Lift up your hands to the holy place and bless the Lord. May the Lord bless you from Zion, he who made heaven and earth. Amen. Our hymn of praise is Rejoice, the Lord is King. It's on the inside of your bulletin. Let's sing together. Let's pray together. Our Father, you are our God and our King, and we come to you on the day that your Son rose up from the grave, was powerfully declared to be the Son of David, the Son of God, and so we know that his kingdom cannot fail. We pray that you would give us strength to believe in the triumph of his kingdom. Bless us now as we worship you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, for Christ's sake. Amen. Please be seated. The coronavirus, as you know, has brought many changes in society and the way we live. One of the changes is we don't have our normal hymn sing on Sunday nights, but if there are hymns you'd like to sing, you can email those to the church office, office@fpfo.org, and we'll try to work those into the rotation. But also, one of the changes is that we will be able to read more scripture in worship, and so we'll be reading through Romans, at least for now, and maybe in about 20 weeks we'll finish Romans. And that's not because I don't know how many chapters are in Romans. We won't have evening worship on the first Lord's Day of the month. But so maybe in about 20 weeks we'll finish Romans and then be somewhere else. But hear now the word of the Lord, Paul's letter to the church at Rome. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, who was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the Spirit of holiness by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ, our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations, including you who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all those in Rome who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. First, I thank my God through Jesus Christ for all of you, because your faith is proclaimed in all the world. For God is my witness, whom I serve with my spirit in the gospel of his Son, that without ceasing I mention you always in my prayers, asking that somehow by God's will I may now at last succeed in coming to you. For I long to see you, that I may impart to you some spiritual gift to strengthen you, that is, that we may be mutually encouraged by each other's faith, both yours and mine. I do not want you to be unaware, brethren, that I have often intended to come to you, but thus far have been prevented, in order that I may reap some harvest among you as well as among the rest of the Gentiles. I am under obligation both to Greeks and to barbarians, both to the wise and to the foolish. So I am eager to preach the gospel to you also who are in Rome. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith for faith. As it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made. So they are without excuse. For although they knew God, they did not honor God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Therefore, God gave them up in the lusts of their heart to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this reason, God gave them up to dishonorable passions. For their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another. Men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They're full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they know God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them. Amen. Thus far in God's holy, inspired, and inerrant word, here in Romans 1, the apostle indicts, as it were, the Gentiles. And who among us would not be guilty of something he indicts the Gentile nations with, showing the depravity of humanity extends to all people. And it is a depravity that is manifested in our denial of what we know about God. Well, let's go to God in prayer. Our evening prayer, another addition or change because of the different situation that we now live in. Our evening prayer will be one of both adoration and thanksgiving, not so much as with the morning prayer, one of intercession. And so let's go to God in prayer. Let's pray together. O Lord, our God and Heavenly Father, you look down from your throne above the heavens on the children of man, and you see there is indeed no one who seeks after you. There is no one who understands, but our whole race is corrupt and does no good. And yet you were pleased to show mercy to a race of rebels and traitors, to bring us to praise you for your grace and for your majestic perfections and for your infinite being. Our Father, you took what we had ruined and destroyed and killed, and you raised us up so that we could be found by you, and so you would find us, so we may seek after you in faith and find refuge and manifest your glory in our lives. And so, our Father, we have so many things for which we ought to thank you, not least of which for our salvation, and yet many more things beside. We praise you for the good result from John Watson's knee surgery last week. Would you strengthen him in his recovery? Grant Joyce to look after him well, to have energy to care for him and for her mother. We thank you that even in the sorrow and the frustrations that have come because of the resurgence of the coronavirus here, your people have continued to care for one another, to love one another, to keep in touch with one another, to encourage one another. We thank you that though we may disagree on how to respond to the coronavirus, our differences of opinion have not become disagreements and divisions within the body of your beloved Son. We thank you that even in sickness and weakness, your people in our midst have testified to your grace and sustaining power. Will Davis, as he battled cancer, and now his daughter-in-law facing a renewed campaign in her own fight with cancer, as they testify that it is your grace that carries them onward and upholds them. We thank you that even though we cannot make a collection or offering in the midst of the worship service, yet the giving to the worship and work of this congregation has not seen a drastic shortfall. And so we praise you for the generosity, the sacrificial giving of so many of your people who are faithful to their vows of membership and give that the work may go on here. We thank you that you have thus far spared our congregation from death through this new disease. We know, our Father, that could change tomorrow. And if it please you and if it bring you glory, we know that you will give us the wisdom and the ability to minister in that situation too. That if it is your will that some of us be afflicted with this coronavirus, you will not forsake them, you will not forsake us, but you will continue to sustain us. Our Lord, we have so much for which to be thankful, so much we have not even mentioned, and yet hear us now as we offer to you more thanksgivings in our own hearts, because all we have and are is from you. And now, Father, thank you for inviting us to call on you and to come before you through Christ, your beloved Son, our mediator and our King. Amen. Well, let's stand and sing to God's praise from Psalm number 13. It's on the inside of the bulletin. Let's sing to God's praise together.
Oh,
Amen. Please be seated. If you have your Bible, would you take it out and turn with me to Psalm 13? This is a troubling psalm to some. Perhaps as you sung the words, you found it shocking, as we sang it a moment ago. This is a realist psalm, isn't it? This psalm is not for people who merely want a respectable religion, a religion that doesn't address or confront the problems and hardships and disappointments of life. Some people want a religion just like that, a superficial happiness to mask how miserable we are. But this psalm and others like it make people uncomfortable. But it's a psalm that reveals just how well God's word knows us. Maybe some of you have gone through life without any real problems, no real disappointments. Your kids always did great. Your boss always thought your work was exemplary. Your spouse just thinks that you are the paragon of perfection. You see a doctor once a year and she marvels at how healthy you are. Everyone in your community loves and adores you. Even your neighbor's half-stray mongrel doesn't dare come into your yard. Maybe that's you. Maybe that's your life. And your life is all peaches and cream. But for the rest of us who have known despair and depression and the feeling of being deserted by God, here is a psalm for the likes of us. This is a psalm for times when sorrow prevails. David takes his frustrations to God, doesn't he? How well this psalm contrasts with where we were this morning in Exodus 17. Nothing is going David's way, but rather than grumble about God, rather than gripe about God's providence, David goes directly to God with his sorrow and his frustration. This is a psalm for times like our own. Some weeks ago, the Christian poet, the hip-hop artist, and Reformed Theological Seminary student, Jackie Hill Perry, received a great deal of criticism for something she posted on social media. She said, in effect, that white Christianity does not have songs to sing for the times we are now in. She was alluding, I think, to the overwhelming sense of triumphalism that characterized the songs, the hymns that were written largely in the last century and a half. And she was right about that. She was right in her diagnosis. Now her remedy was faulty. She said we need just to sing Negro spirituals. And while that's part of the remedy, perhaps, the biblical remedy is not simply to change the ethnic group from where we're getting our hymns and our songs. The remedy is to look to the scripture and to sing the psalms God has given his people to sing. Our time is one in which God's people have much to lament and grieve together and individually. We've been locked down and locked out of a proper public worship service since the middle of March, because of this coronavirus. Some of you watching on the live stream have not left your homes in more than 100 days except on rare, absolutely necessary trips. That in and of itself would be a reason to pour out your heart to God in lament. We live in a culture in which a pedophile seems to have had close association with some of the most powerful and influential people on both sides of the Atlantic Ocean. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. And how much more? What can we do when it appears society's elites have been engaged in a cabal of child abuse? We are in the midst of a public scandal that has revealed the callous disregard of human life by many police agencies throughout the land. Breonna Taylor late of Louisville, Kentucky, is only the most recent victim of a police agency carelessly going to the wrong house and shooting someone for no reason. In that case, in her own bed. Our society views the life of poor and working class people cheaply. What can the righteous do? Or maybe you've been following the treatment and the vaccine efforts for this coronavirus, and you've seen there are quite a few promising efforts out there, and you for a moment let your heart rejoice, but as you did your research, you soon discovered some of those vaccines are made from the organs of unwanted children, murdered by Planned Parenthood and then sold to the highest bidder. What are we to say when our society exterminates the children of its weakest members for the purpose of culling their organs so that more desirable members of society can have a vaccine and get back to normal? God knew full well the wickedness of the world in which we live. And he so kindly gave his people psalms to sing and to pray to him for times just like this. There's a movement in the book of Psalms. You know how the book of Psalms is not chronological. Psalm 11, though, David wrote of the calm confidence of the believer, even in the midst of trouble. In the Lord I take refuge, David said. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is heaven. His eyes see, his eyelids test the children of man. That's Psalm 11. But then Psalm 12, David's confidence is still there, but it's wavering. As he says, "Save, O Lord, for the godly one is gone, for the faithful have vanished among the children of man." And then we come to Psalm 13, where David feels abandoned by God. His sense that God sees is not there, at least at the beginning. And so he despairs both of life and of death. And he languishes in some middle place of spiritual depression. And so I want to see three things, God willing, with you this evening. Anxiety in verses 1 and 2. And then praying by faith. And then assurance in verses 5 and 6. Before we read God's word, let's ask his help and blessing. God in heaven, we thank you and praise you for your word, which is our hope. Our hope is not in what we have done or in what we feel, even in how faithful we are in our faith. Our hope, our confidence is in your word. And so speak to us as we consider these difficult words, or at least words that were written by David in a very difficult time, that you would give us confidence for our own heartache as we look around us. And it seems as though injustice will prevail, and yet we know that you will restore and you will make right. And yet we pray, our Father, that your righteous reign would give us confidence even for times such as these. For Jesus' sake, amen. Psalm 13, to the choir master, a psalm of David. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my own soul and have sorrow in my heart all the day? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Light up my eyes, lest the sleep of death come to me. Lest my enemy say, I have prevailed over him. Lest my foes rejoice because I am shaken. But I have trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. Amen, thus far in God's holy, inspired, and inerrant word. Let's look at verses 1 and 2, David's anxiety. David has four questions. Some of the questions he puts out there multiple times. He's desperate, he's weary, he's anxious, he's in distress. And he asks God four times, how long will this continue? We get a sense of his urgency in his cries, don't we? Time, says one commentator, has become a destructive force, wearing down the ability of David to hold out. David's conditions are intolerable. He feels, he senses, he cannot continue. He lacks the strength in himself to carry on. And so he says, how long, O Lord? I wonder how many of us have been afraid to ask that question. How many of us have been afraid, thinking it would be impious to ask God, how long will this go on? But here in the inspired, inerrant Word of God, he has given that very question to us so we can better learn how to pray. And he says, how long will this continue? And did you notice the superscript? This is a psalm for the choir master. This was a psalm to be sung in the public worship of God. David has a threefold agony. We don't know why or what has led David to suffer in this way. It's not some apparent sin for which he's being chastised. It's not necessarily an illness. It may simply be that people don't like David. For example, Saul was jealous, and he pursued David almost until the day of Saul's death. David suffered a lot, but his suffering is made more severe here because of what he feels in the midst of the suffering. There are three troubles that make this suffering to be anguish and agony. In verse 1, it's a spiritual suffering. He feels as though God has forgotten him in the midst of his trouble. In this instance, it appears God's presence is withdrawn from David, not necessarily because of some high-handed sin of David, but inexplicably. And that makes the anguish all the more deep, because David cannot understand why. David feels, perhaps, if he sensed God's presence, God's approval, God's blessing in the midst of that sorrow, he just might manage. But that is gone. He feels abandoned by God, and it is agony. I was listening over the course of a few months to a podcast that was set, it was interviewing people in the town in Mississippi in which we formerly lived. And there was, I think I may have mentioned this before, there was a man some almost 30 years ago who was convicted of murdering four people in that town. And his case just went again to the Supreme Court of the United States, where the conviction was vacated again. But in the course of these interviewers talking to people in Winona about that man's conviction, his sister was interviewed, and she said it was her faith. Now, I think some of the things she said in her faith were not quite accurate, but it was her faith, her sense of God's presence, that allowed her to continue on. When everyone around her in that community, everyone in power, was saying her brother was guilty of a heinous murder, and yet she said, I have faith in God that justice will come out. And indeed, at least the Supreme Court thought his conviction was unjust. And so now he's on his way to getting justice. But here David has no sense of God's approval, no sense that God will ever give him a sense of his presence. Will you forget me forever? That's where David is right now. He doesn't know if God will ever again shine on him with the light of his countenance. If David will ever feel again the Aaronic benediction. It's not that God doesn't see. It's not that God is ignorant of David's plight. David's theology hasn't changed. He still believes in the omniscience and the omnipresence of God. God is aware of David's troubles. But God seems to be ignoring. And that is what makes it unbearable. And so David stammers, "How long?" William Swan Plummer said, "There is no darkness so dreadful as spiritual darkness." But we must realize that when God delays relief of our afflictions, he has wise reasons for doing so. But we should see here in verse 1 that it is no sin to cry out honestly to God when God seems hidden. When your circumstances are more than you can bear and you are wondering, where is God and how long is this going to go on? The Lord Jesus Christ knew affliction, distress, and sorrow. Isaiah 63:9, in all their affliction, he was afflicted. In his affliction and anguish, the Savior cried out to God in this very way. Hebrews 5:7-9, in the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Loud cries came up to God as reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him. The Lord Jesus Christ has opened up a new and living way for us to bring our complaint to God, even when our complaint is the way we feel about his providence. What a contrast between David and Israel in Exodus 17. And so David's problems are spiritual, and now in verse 2, his problems are psychological. David is alone with his thoughts. And you know, when you're alone with your thoughts, that can be a very lonely place. God, having seemingly withdrawn David's mind, now races with ways he can escape the peril under which he suffers. But all his plans are in vain, and so he despairs further. How many of us have been there? Your world seems to be crashing down. Health, financial, professional, relational problems. You're in bed, you're trying to sleep, to escape the quagmire in which you seem trapped, and every solution you conceive quickly breaks down as you run it through your mind, and you cannot conceive of any escape. That's where David is. He's in turmoil because of the futility of his thoughts, and so he cries out again, "How long will I take counsel in my own soul and have sorrow all the day?" And so David's problems are spiritual, they're psychological, and now they're social. Look at that, alliteration. It's a $5 sermon right here. Social problems. God seems to have abandoned him. His own wits are failing him as he tries to conceive of an escape for himself. And to top it all off, his enemies are gloating over it. How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Now, not many of us have literally had people want to kill us. But all of us, in one way or another, have shuddered at the prospect of humiliation and failure. And that's what David is facing. People want him to fail. The enemy seems to be triumphing. Who is the enemy here? Well, I don't know. Particularly, at least, but I know generally. The devil is the father of injustice and oppression. And whatever David is enduring, yes, it is subject to God's providence, but it is also to the agency of the devil, God's enemy and ours. And so it's a fair question to ask as we see injustice triumph in the short term, when we see wickedness seemingly on the ascendancy, death on the march throughout the world. How long will the enemy triumph? When will God allow justice to roll down and sweep away and give a reckoning to the wicked? And so here David is up to his neck in trouble, but his trouble and his suffering become despair and depression because it seems as though God has forgotten. God seems to be withholding blessing. And so he's left to his own to figure out a way. And you know, he's failing at every turn. His enemies are looking for any opportunity to discredit or destroy him, and he'll be humiliated. This is a reminder that dark days are nothing new to the people of God. Don't be surprised when fiery trial come upon you as if something strange were happening, but instead, count it all joy, my beloved brethren, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. How true the Bible is. How well God understands his weak and stumbling people. When we are in more trouble than we think God should allow us to endure, God knew we would need words to pray to him when we think his timing is off. William Swan Plummer again, God's time of deliverance is commonly further off than man's ignorance esteems best, yet it is often nearer than man's unbelief allows him to hope. When everything seems to be crashing down and you're trying to think of a way out, but everything is a dead end, here's a psalm to sing. When you don't know what else to say because it seems as though God has abandoned you, here are words that God gives you to call out to him in the depths of despair. Well, that's David's anxiety, but what about David's prayer? Verses 3 and 4. This is illogical, isn't it? David has just cried and mourned God's apparent abandonment. Lamenting, God is not paying attention to me. Grieving that God has withheld blessings. But what does David do next? He prays. To the very same Lord whom David feels does not hear him, has forgotten him, and hides his face from him. He prays to him. This is not the easy believism. This is no Christianity in which you say a few words, recite a prayer, walk an aisle, and then everything in your life suddenly falls into place and all your troubles disappear and raindrops and become lemon drops and gumdrops. Although, what a world that would be. This is the real world, though, isn't it? David has faith in his God. That is how David can carry on like this, because he knows his God. He carries on. He knows what his God is like. He knows what William Cooper knew. Blind unbelief is sure to err and scan his work in vain. Judge not the Lord by feeble sense, but trust him for his grace. Behind a frowning providence, he hides a smiling face. David does not rest his faith in what he personally experiences. David does not base his religion merely on how well things are going at the moment or what his eyes see and hear, but he keeps on praying. David endures because his faith is based on what he knows of his God. Knowledge is the ground and basis of David's faith. He calls out not just to God, not just to Yahweh. But he's more bold than that. He calls out to Yahweh, my God. He pours on the urgency and the pressure, not only by calling out to him and calling him by name, but reminding God of the relationship they have. You are the Lord. You are Yahweh. You are my God. He's drawing on that scriptural principle, that relationship principle that governs the way God is with his people. And you remember, it's that refrain from Genesis to Revelation. As God declares the kind of relationship he will have with his people time and again, I will be your God and you will be my people. That's what David is appealing to here. He's playing up that relationship. You are my God, David cries. And because you're my God, I'm your people. I'm your person. Because I belong to you, you have obligations to me. And so even in the midst of despair and distress, David is thinking biblically. He's thinking covenantally. He's pleading with God, using the terms that the covenant God has made with his people. I will be your God and you will be my people. David is persevering in faith because he knows the scripture. And because David knows the scripture, he knows what God is like and he does not lose heart. But he's bold to ask God to do for him because God will not cut off his people. And so David asks three things of God, and all of these are related. He asks, give attention to me, that is, stop ignoring my plight, consider me. He asks, answer me, don't be silent, give me a sense that you care. And he asks, lighten my eyes, change my circumstances. God, act on behalf of your people. Do not give me over to death. But show me your face, because your face brings blessings. And so you see, by way of application, how David is faltering. He's concerned his wavering faith will give out, and so he musters all he has, and as it turns out, it's not enough. And so he pleads with the God of the covenant, don't you forsake me. Because David knows God does not break his covenants. And so what is the answer to wavering faith? How do you strengthen wavering faith? You look at God's word and what God has covenanted and promised to do for his people. And you look at what God is like. And you rest in who God is because he has shown he is God who keeps his promises. But David gives God some reasons to act also. In verse 3, it was God's covenant, but in verse 4, it's David's enemy. Who is the enemy? Maybe it's Saul. Is it one of David's other political or international rivals? Maybe. But who is the ultimate enemy? It's Satan. It's death itself. Satan seeks to discredit God, to undermine God's promises by causing God's people to slip and to stumble and to succumb to sin. Remember how Paul earnestly reminded Timothy to keep a watch over himself because, you know, often we're our own worst enemy, aren't we? In terms of holiness and godliness as we slip back into sinful patterns. And so David here is desperate that God would save him so his enemies will be denied victory. So they will not see David fall. How many folks have you known who have been undone, not by anything other than their own poor choices and a lack of striving for holiness? It's easy to fall, to stumble, to succumb to the pressures of sin when you're lamenting, when you're suffering. And so David knows the spiritual danger he is in because of all the bad things that are transpiring around him. And so he is pleading with God to protect his own honor as much as David's. He says, if I fall, it's not only my disgrace, but your disgrace too, as it implies you were unwilling or unable to preserve me. David fears a certain type of death here. The defeat David fears here is not merely one in which the body ceases to be alive, but spiritual death. He recognizes spiritual death as a real danger for him. His troubles are so severe that his assurance of salvation is shaken. He feels cut off from his God, and he genuinely fears his foes will triumph over him unless God sustains him. Let's consider a couple things by way of application here. One, we must recognize our own spiritual weakness, that only God preserves us so we can persevere in faith. We must recognize our own spiritual weakness, especially when we are grieved by our circumstances. Because in such times, there are ample opportunities to respond in a sinful way. But we should also see by way of application, as we doubt our own ability and are being puzzled by God's providence, doubt of our own ability and being bewildered by God's providence, that is not unbelief. That is faith seeking understanding. And we must take our doubts and our disappointments and our lack of understanding to God's word and to God himself and to the throne of grace to find grace to help in time of need. We must recognize the doubt of our own ability and being puzzled. That is an opportunity to rest in God's sufficiency all the more. Let's look at David's assurance now in verses 5 and 6. David takes another turn, and at first glance, it seems, again, to be a non sequitur. He's just confessed his own weakness, ignorance, and doubts, and he's now talking about God's steadfast love. He's rejoicing now in God's salvation. This seems to be illogical, but actually it's the only way, isn't it? He has prayed, he has confessed, he has no strength of his own, but his comfort comes from God's steadfast love. At the beginning of the psalm, David was looking inward, wasn't he? His perspective was defective. How long will you forget me, David said. I feel like you've forgotten me. You're hiding from me. How long must I figure this out on my own? How long are my enemies to gloat over me? At the beginning of the psalm, he was focused on himself. But now, where is David? At the depth of his despair, he learned he doesn't have any strength in himself. His own faith is not strong enough to persevere. And so his trust can't be in his own faith. How often are we like that, though? How often do we hear people say, you just have to believe. You just have to have faith that we can do this. But it's not about our faith, is it? David has painfully learned the emptiness of faith in faith, of faith in himself. And so he looks higher and he rests his hope in the object of his faith. And so a great change comes over David, not because he has received what Ralph Davis calls a self-esteem shot. But David is revived and refreshed because he's no longer looking inward, but once again looking at his God. It is David's faith. It is not David's faith that will save him. It is his God. David is still in the pit of depression, but now there's a light. He can get his bearings. He has remembered what his God is like. You see, God's steadfast covenant love remains David's hope no matter what else is going on. No matter what else David feels, what he knows to be true is God's love for his people. That his people are dependable. It is a love that does not let go. It is a love that chases after his people because God is committed to his people. And so David speaks of his faith and the object of his faith. But now he's moved to praise in verse 6. David has not yet received answers to his petitions. He has not received answers to even the questions that he began. How long? How long? How long? But look at where he is now. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. Earlier he was depressed, despairing. He was despondent. But four verses later, he's singing God's praises. But nothing has changed for David's situation. What is the cause of this change in his attitude? The problems have not gone away. The problems have not gotten better in the space of six verses. But what has changed is David's perspective on his trouble, his afflictions and sorrows. And you know, that's what makes all the difference in the world. David is once again looking to God and realize, though he may not feel God's presence, God has not forgotten David in his trials. It is God who now sustains David through this overwhelming flood. David repels temptation by confidently resting in God's bountiful care, God's bountiful plans for his people. We don't often use that word, dealing bountifully. We don't speak like that nowadays. Maybe that's too many characters for Twitter. I don't know. But to deal bountifully, that means you don't simply give a person what she or he deserves or asked for, but generously. You give more. David says, I will sing to my God because he has dealt bountifully with me. I have trusted him from my youth. He has never disappointed me. Though oft I have failed him, so I will continue to trust this God in the future because he has dealt bountifully with me. Would you turn to Romans chapter 8? What does God dealing bountifully look like? Look at Romans 8 and verse 32. He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? This is the measure of God's bounty, God's generosity to his people. He will not forsake you, for he has given his son to redeem you out of every sin. His son was forsaken by God. That is how God can be so faithful to his people. He can continue to deal graciously with his people because he gave his son to redeem, to buy back his people. It's not that David can redeem himself. And so we can be confident in sorrow and affliction, even despair and depression, knowing God will not abandon his own. Because Christ was forsaken, because the Father turned his face away from his son and he laid on him the iniquity of us all, there is forgiveness and pardon for sinful people. Because Jesus was given over to death, our enemy, the grave, cannot prevail. Because God's Son was not shown steadfast love, but was abandoned to the death and the hell of God's wrath on Golgotha, God will show steadfast, faithful love to all who put their faith not in themselves or in generic hope, but to all who put their faith in Christ's work and obedience. God promises adoption and forgiveness. And so when you are in despair, when the light seemed to have gone, when everything you thought was fine is now scattered and broken, when your life is a mess because of the choices you made, when you are weighed down with sorrow because of the things you see going on, remember God who deals bountifully with his people, not because we have our lives in order, but because he put forward his beloved son so that he could kill his beloved son, so that you could dwell in God's presence and live by the light of his face forevermore, where he will show us the immeasurable riches of his grace toward us as he, with Christ, gives us all things. Let's pray. Father, please hear our prayers. Please take away the reasons for our despair. Let us take refuge in your covenant faithfulness and boldly speak of your goodness and love and righteousness and justice. The justice from which we have been spared. And so, Father, bring glory to yourself in our walking before you in the Lord Jesus Christ. For we pray in his name. Amen. Let's respond to God's word with Abide With Me. Let's stand and sing together. Receive now God's blessing upon his people. Peace be to the brethren, and love with faith through Jesus Christ, until the day breathes and the shadows flee away. Amen.